Hello, my name's David West, and I'm the author of this book, The Goat, the Devil, and the Freemason. I've been asked several times how the title came about. My Masonic brother Leslie is a very kind person, a vegetarian, a retired policeman, and a counsellor. I was therefore very surprised to learn that some members of his extended family, hearing he was an active Freemason, accused him of being a devil worshipper. Shortly after that, someone asked me, quite seriously, whether a live goat was part of Masonic ceremonies. Now, a moment's thought would show that the goat question is very silly. No one would allow a goat into the places that Freemasons meet, the local hotel or Masonic temple, and certainly not into Freemasons' Hall, perhaps the most beautiful example of Art Deco in England, and the venue of many TV dramas and fashion parades. I mean, goats are not exactly house-trained. I found these ideas really fascinating. I mean, how and where do such odd ideas come from? Both are daft ideas, but the fact that they arise and are talked about is in itself interesting. I decided to find out how and why. The research was absorbing, and the 236 pages of the book I really avoid through the research. 236 may sound a lot, but there are 70-odd pictures in the book as well. The ideas have a very visual history. Ideas such as the goat and the devil in Freemasonry do not spring from one person's imagination. They develop and change as they pass through time, with one idea leading to another, being combined with a third, and so on. Thus the book is a sort of family history of ideas, going back in time to find the ancestors and then tracing their descendants, with many surprises along the way. For example, it turns out that the first people to be accused of devil worship were members of the early Christian church. These accusations occurred a long while before Freemasonry existed. It was also a surprise to discover parallels between post-exile Jews and the Shawnee Indian nation, and to find that the devil, if there can be said to be such an entity, is not named Lucifer. I start the search for the ideas of goats, devils, and Freemasonry in the time of ancient Egypt, the time of the pharaohs. There were no Freemasons around then, of course, but it is in ancient Egypt that we find the idea of goats, or more properly, rams, horns being associated with sex. Right there is the beginning of the idea of the devil as a horned figure. From there, the family history takes us through such fascinating areas as Egyptian, Greek, and Roman ideas of the divine, the writing of the Bible, early Christianity, various creation stories, the Crusades, and not only in the Holy Land, Civil War in Germany, the fur trappers in early America, the science of magic, occult in 19th century France, and a marvellous Masonic hoax. We meet at least two Cleopatras, Cyrus the Great, the Bogomils and the Cathars, Saint Augustine, Hume and Nietzsche, Ludwig Wittgenstein, and the wonderfully named Hermes Trismegistus, as well as Kit Carson, Old Bill Williams and Crazy Horse. We travel the Silk Route, the Fertile Crescent, the Santa Fe Trail, and the Comanche area. Ideas that live through history collect the power of associations on the way. They pass through many hands and many beliefs, gaining weight as they do so. It is a marvellous tale. I studied and later taught philosophy at university. My doctorate of philosophy is in philosophy. This helps. Dealing with such concepts as the devil and worship, for example, requires analysing their meaning, indeed, whether they have any. I try as far as possible to keep the main text free of such complications, but I do have a series of interludes into which philosophy intrudes. The problem with such ideas as these is that they can take you into all sorts of wonderful byways and highways. I confess I do not always resist the temptation, but I put the more obvious excursions away from the main road into these interludes, taking the name from the breaks between programs that were used in the early days of television. I enjoyed the excursions, and I hope that you will too, but you can pick and choose. I did not set out to write a Masonic book as such. The book is about goats, devils, and Freemasons, but it also makes reference to rock and roll, Kabbalah, the Rosicrucians, and the Blackfoot Indian Nation. I hope that what I have written will interest non-Masons as well. The writer and broadcaster Stephen O'Shea, author of The Perfect Heresy, The Life and Death of the Cathars, describes the book as erudite, eccentric, and entertaining. I think that's very fair. I had a lot of fun researching and writing the book, and I hope the fun comes over in the text.